Have four very exciting talks, so try not to fall out of your seats with excitement. Our first presenter will be Yicheng Wu. He's joined on this paper by his co-authors Vivek Bhuminathan, George Chen, Ashwin Shankar Narayan, and Ashok Veeraraghavan. And this is from Rice University and Carnegie Mellon. Please go ahead.
Thank you. Uh, 3D imaging provides a unique spatial context. And with this spatial context, there are a lot of applications, such as autonomous cars, AR or VR system, and drones. As a consequence of the growth in applications, there are a lot of 3D sensors on the market, everything from structured light to stereo. Interferometry to LiDAR and continuous time of flight to camera arrays. We cannot study one by one, but in general, they can be divided into two categories, active or passive. For most mobile applications, due to the power constraint, active is not the suitable choice. That means passive method is the right fit. Currently, the most common used 3D sensors is stereo or camera array, which involve multiple cameras fusing information together. So the question we ask is that, can we design passive and a single view 3D sensors? We offered one solution called FaceCam 3D. It consists of two parts. The first part is a face mask-based camera, which encodes depth from the scene to the sensor. And the second part is a reconstruction algorithm that extracts the depth from the sensor. To find the optimal parameter for both two parts, we regard the entire system as a neural network. And for the first layer, it's an optical layer, so it's model how the physics looks like in our camera system. And the second part is the digital network, so it's computationally extract the depth from the sensor. As a neural network, we can learn this entire network using backpropagation algorithms, both for digital network and optical layers. Well, to convince you that this is a design for passive single view 3D sensor, there are two questions to be answered. First, why should we use a face mask-based camera? And second, why should we use an end-to-end learning framework? So for the first question, let's go back and see how people try to estimate depth based on single view image. When you take an image of a scene, here's how it looks like. Everything on the focal planes becomes sharp, while all the rest of the scenes is blurred. And the blur size is actually related to the depth. That's a key idea of depth from defocus. And here is the optical model of a lens system. So if the point from the focal plane, then it becomes a dot on the sensor, while if it is off the focal plane, it becomes a disk. So here is the PSF at different depths. So because the lens system is symmetric, so the PSF will look identical at both sides of the focal plane, which means that it's impossible to tell the depth based on the blur size. So in order to extract depth from these seams, the optical system has to be modified. PSF can be engineered by insert a mask on the object plane. And for example, for amplitude mask, it generates patterns by block part of the object planes. So it will break the symmetric of the PSF and generate PSF that's different at different depths. However, it suffers from low light throughput. And also, the difference in PSF across depths is only in scale, which means that the PSF variability is very low. In contrast, for a face mask design, it's just basically a piece of glass with designed head map. So it generates patterns on the sensors by bend the light. So there's no light loss. And more importantly, this face mask can generate more interesting patterns. As one example here, So this is called a double helix PSF, which consists of two dots. And as depths change, these two dots just rotate. So because of the high light throughput and the high PSF variability, that's the reason why we use a face mask-based sensor. Now, the second question is why we use an end-to-end approach. To understand why, let's see what's the current stage of the 3D sensors with a face mask. So in current stage, the face mask design actually follows a stepwise approach, meaning that the face mask is first designed by theory or heuristic assumptions. And then the algorithm is designed to maximize the depth estimation. An interesting paper was published in 2014 by Shuckman that's trying to use a face mask for 3D microscopy. So according to their paper, facial information describes the sensitivity of the face mask change in 3D location of a scene. And by minimizing this facial loss, they find their optimal mask. Then they use a template matching algorithm to do 3D localization. So they successfully show that they are able to recover 3D trajectory based on a 2D microscopy videos. While this is a very elegant pipeline, but the face mask and the algorithm are designed separately. And also, the facial information theory might only be valid for fluorescent samples, which the theme is actually very sparse and consists of pointed light source. But in real world, the theme is always very dense with edges and flat regions, where none of them can be easily modeled in theory. That's why we built an end-to-end learning approach with the exclusive goal of estimated depths as our end goal. And after the learning process, we will find the optimal face mask. Then we just fabricate this and put into a conventional camera system. And then from the capture image, just by passing through this digital network, we're able to get the depth map. So that's a key idea of our sensor. I've explained why we built this system. Now, the next question is that how we build this. Specifically, there are three questions to be answered. First, how to model the optical layer. Second, how to model the digital layer. And third, how to train the entire network. For the optical layer, we know that the image on the sensor is a convolution of the object with the PSF. And the PSF can be calculated based on the Fourier theory, which is the magnitude of the Fourier transformation of the pupil function. And the pupil function consists of two parts. One part is from the face mask, which is a function of the hand map edge. And the other part is the defocus turn, which is a function of the depth z. And then to get the image on the sensor, we build our image information model. So we basically discretize the 3D object by depths and convolve with their corresponding PSFs and sum them up. And in order to mimic real scenes, we add the noise in our model. So finally, the image sensor image is a function of depth edge. And so we first find the optical layer, and then what's the digital network? So the goal of digital network is actually estimate the depth based on the coded image. We use a standard UNET architecture. The reason is because UNET is actually very good for pixel-wise prediction. And also, the input and output pairs share some similarity in space. So we think the skip combination is very useful. So the last question is how to train the network. So in order to train this, we need to have a data set. So the data set we need to have is both have the RGB information and depth information. And there are several experimental data sets available, but they all have issues in boundary mismatch or missing depths. So in our case, we use a synthetic data set with precise texture and depth. And this is how they look like. In terms of the loss function, we use root mean square loss to compare the difference between the estimated depth and the ground truth depth. We also find that gradient loss is very important to ask me the edge information. And the last thing is that in our case, we find that mask initialization is actually very important. So if you just do a random initialization and it actually doesn't learn the optimal parameter automatically. This is due to the highly non-convex nature of our optimization. So instead, we initialize this based on the facial information, which is used for 3D microscopy, and this helps us to achieve the best performance. So we all have these three pieces of information, and we can learn our network now. And here is the best result from our paper. So the first one shows the hand map of the face mask. And based on the face mask, we can calculate the PSF at different depths. As you can see here, there are large difference among the depths that give you the intuition that this is able to give you a good depth estimation. And here's one example. So the first image is the sharp image with all focus information. And the second one is a coded image that's rendered with our mask. And based on the coded image, we're able to estimate the depth. And it's actually quite similar to our ground truth disparity. As a comparison, we compared our result with other amplitude mask design. So basically, we trained three different models. And for each neural network, the optical layer is designed based on these three different designs. And the same architecture of the UNet is used to extract the depths. As shown here, in terms of the RMS loss, our result is much better. And there are other kind of comparison. Please check our paper. So given the good results from the simulation, we fabricate the learned face mask using a 2-photon lithography 3D printer. And here's the mask that we fabricate. The entire size is less than 3 millimeters. And then we put this mask on the aperture of our commercial DSLR lenses. Although the PSF of the face mask is known from simulation, we calibrate our prototype camera to account for any mismatch by physical implementation, such as the aberration in the fabricated mask or misalignment. So basically, we adapted optimization based method. So the input pairs will be the all-in focus image with the mask and the fixed focal plane image with the mask. So based on the deconvolution algorithms, we're able to estimate the depths at all the different depths. So based on this PSF, we can fine tune the digital network so that the digital network can also match the experimental PSFs. And here's the experimental results. So the first column corresponding to the image captured by our sensor. And the bottom one is the estimated disparity map. So as we can see here, it's quite robust for both indoor seams and outdoor seams. And the object with smooth surface or like sharp edge can also be well handled. And even for this case, this is a transparent object, which is normally very hard for depth estimation, but still be able to handle it. And here are several other results with the reconstructed depth map. And even the area without the texture, the network is able to learn a reasonable depth estimation. So in order to evaluate our system, we compared our result with Kinect system. So basically, we captured the same scene with both these two cameras. While both of us gave some similar depth estimation, actually, our FaceCam 3D gave you much smoother edges. Besides, we captured a planar target at various known depths and compute the depths. So as plot here, this is the actual depths, and this is the estimated depths. And based on this figure, we can see that actually we are reliably estimate depths among a large range from 0.4 meters to 0.9 meters with a standard deviation about 1.25 centimeters. In conclusion, I think we have two main contributions. So first, we built a passive single view depth sensor. And we showed that experimentally that our sensors can achieve good quality depth estimation. And second, we explored the idea of end-to-end learning framework, which is joint design hardware and software. Similar ideas are proposed by Chakrabi in 2016 to design bare patterns for natural seams, and also from Sisman to design lens for achromatic EDOF systems. Well, in our case, we designed this face mask for the depth estimation task. And we think it can be easily extended for example, for other tasks like face imaging, or even some high-level ideas, high-level tasks like object detection. So we are very excited to see more kind of work can be done in this field. Thank you.
All right, we have time for a few questions.
Thank you for your presentation. I have actually two questions related to the,
sure.
the paper.
Sure.
First one is because you are, firstly, you use the synthetic data to train the whole system.
Mm-hmm.
Then when you actually implement it, there's supposed to have some kind of noise or mismatch between your mask. So did you, what kind of characteristic of that noise, is it random or is it structured? Or, and then my next question is, do you consider the noise when you train the whole system? Because you didn't mention anything about it when you do the training.
Sorry, so for the first question, you're concerned about I'm using a synthetic data set, there's some mismatch?
Yes, it's synthetic, and then you implement it in your system, so they're supposed to have some kind of noise.
So you mean like a mismatch between synthetic data set versus our actual real seams? Is that your question?
Yes. So do you consider it when you do the training?
So even though we use synthetic data set, but the rendering model, so the way to capture, like to simulate how the coded image looks like, is actually a physics-based method. So as long as you have this one-to-one correspondence that is physically correct, then if we even we use a synthetic data set, we are still be able to get good results in the experimental setup. And can you repeat your second question, sorry?
Yeah, so my second question is if you consider that kind of mismatch between the synthetic data and the real data, when you do the training, will it be helpful?
Not really, actually. Actually, in our first test, we use NYU data set. So you know, NYU data set is like experimental data set. But the reason is, as I mentioned, there are a lot of missing missing depths or all these kind of issues. When I use that, it's actually give me even worse result. So yeah, actually, this is when we train the entire seams, we instead of optimize for a depth, we actually estimate a range called normalized disparity map. So that is like a general range that you can optimize for, and then based on that, you can pick your camera systems, and then that's where going to correspond into a depth range. So in short, it means that actually it's not means that if I train this for a particular depth range, it won't work for another. Actually, it will transit to another depth range as long as you find the correct correspondence.
I think we really need to move on. Srinivas, if you could set up.
Yeah, we can talk
offline. You could go ahead and ask your question while he's setting up if you want to continue.
I just had a quick question. So the idea here is that you're trying to learn the ideal phase mask given a UNet.
Yes.
But that thing you actually built looked, the PSF looked quite different from what you designed. So could you comment on how that degraded the performance? Because you had to retrain the UNet. So was that solution with the new PSF and the new UNet comparable to the original, or was it worse, even just in simulation? Thanks.
They do have some difference between like the experimental PSF and the simulated PSF. but actually the if you look at the like the key structure, they are still same. So actually when you fine tune that, it's like only a small change, not a drastically fine tuned process.
Great, let's thank our speaker again.